Welcome to the Two Blokes Chatting Radio Show on 94.7 The Pulse. Music, interviews, news, and, well, Two Blokes Chatting. Now, here are the two blokes.
7 minutes past 10 o'clock on the 100th episode of the Two Blokes Chatting Radio Show. My name's Neil Butler. His name is Rob Cameron. And we are delighted to have a human being in the building because we don't get them very often. A friend of the show, well known across Victoria. What else do I have to say, Eve? Ian Cover from the Could Have Been Champions. Welcome.
Good morning, Two Blokes Chatting. And number one and two.
Good to
Neil
have you.
And Rob. Good. And this, suddenly I felt like, I'm in a time warp. If you'd played the Could Have Been's theme, I would have been really in a time warp because this is the time I sort of spoke on air of a Saturday morning for the last, I don't know, 40 years.
and remarkably, because he's only 35. Hey, we've also got someone on the wireless via the telephone today. And
I thought I was coming on here.
Ian thought
to
he was
get your full and undivided attention.
Well, we thought we'd have a crack at this bloke. Please identify yourself, caller.
Where's Juan Turner?
We have got Ross Stevenson from 3AW Breakfast on the radio.
Hey. Merry Christmas, if I don't hear you.
What's on the air?
Gee, he was in cracking form this week too, Chris, wasn't he?
he's pushing the envelope a bit.
Oh, dear.
But, Kobe, Oracle of Darwin here. Good morning to you.
Good. And a boy from the bush, as you often say. Oh, my place in the bush.
Yes. Now, interestingly, this morning, Ross, and for those who haven't realised the voice, Ross Stevenson from 3AW Breakfast, thanks for joining us as officially now a friend of the show because it's your second crack at it. This morning I was listening when I woke up because my radio doesn't pick up the pulse where I live, and I picked up the 7 o'clock news, and there's a chap called Darren James presenting on your show this morning, and he had a caller called Ian from Barwon Heads putting forward material.
Well, there's quite a few Ians in Barwon Heads.
So I did text him, Ross, and say, keep all your good stuff for the radio. That was the wisdom that you provided with us once.
Well, I should say, too, that Darren and I, we used to be the full-time breakfast presenters on 3AW, and Ross has been filling in for us for the last 30 years. Are you going to take a break at all so we can have our show back?
I was going to say that, as far as I'm aware, every male in Barwon Heads is called Ian or Cadell.
And I'm looking at him across the desk. We're sure it's not Cadell.
No, that's right.
He's too tall.
He's been home this year. He came home in January and only went back a couple of weeks back. And he was asking after you, Ross.
Well, I've seen him at the Grand Prix.
Oh, right. Because other people seen him at the opening night of Hamilton.
Oh, well. And people at the opening night of Hamilton seem to have one thing in common.
Yes, COVID.
Yes, yeah. What's that been like, Oracle, to have a surname so closely associated with a pandemic?
It has happened from time to time. When you have to give your name somewhere and go, Ian COVID, they go, what, COVID? Yeah. Would you mind stepping back 3 metres?
The thing that's puzzled me about that particular stage show is it's been pretty big in Broadway, hasn't it? It's been worldwide. How on earth do you get a musical out of a small country town in Western Victoria that's renowned for its sheep?
Well,
precisely.
Exactly. Yeah. I don't know what they get up and go click. They seem click go the shears on high rotation.
Now, Ian, you can tell me something. Yes. One of the things from going to the bush so regularly, which I can identify as a beautiful
Hamlet
city of the Birragara, is that 99.9% of the population barrack for the Cats.
Oh, as they should.
It must be intellectually stimulating for you then, Ross.
Well, it's isolating is what it is.
Yeah. Mm. I can remember, was it 2007 that Geelong made the preliminary final the first time in that run?
Yeah.
And they did an article in the Geelong Advertiser where they got some poor kid in a Footscray jumper to sit amongst something like 400 Geelong supporters at Newtown or Chilwell Primary or somewhere. And this poor kid, no bullying there, you wouldn't have thought. And the poor kid then had to go to school on the Monday morning, having been completely humiliated.
Well, that was good practice for him, because supporters of visiting clubs are allocated 200 seats at Geelong, which I think is far too many.
I tell you what, if you're an interstate club, you don't get that many. And you get to stare straight into the sun. That's the other really great part about it.
This should be about you this morning, not about me. So let me ask you a question. John Anderson has given every indication of late that Geelong has a young player who is a mixture of
Peter Knights,
Senior, Ablett Junior, Lee Matthews, Dean Carey.
Yeah.
Can you give him a name and tell us about him?
Is that Sam de Kooning?
That's the one.
Yeah. If Bobby Davis was still with us, Ross and Rob and Neil, he'd say, "Oh, I think we've found one." But he'd be calling him, you know, De Conning. He'd be calling him De Conning, or he'd have Dakota. He'd have some name for him.
De Conning.
Yeah. Yeah. Because he would have struggled with Radicalia too, Bobby. But no, he's a very good player. He's a very good player, De Conning. And I did hear, John, the other morning, I was in furious agreement. He hasn't had a nomination for the Rising Star.
Still not.
He only played one game last year. And he's playing as if he actually played for the last couple of years. Yeah. No, he's very good. He's tall. He can jump. He can mark. He's got poise. You watch him have a shocker this afternoon.
That's right. Give away a free kick and lose the game at the end.
He's very good, De Kooning. And he's wearing Billy Brownless's number, 16, which hasn't been a hindrance to him, which is just terrific.
Well, Ian, you can tell Neil and Robin, the listener, well, this is one of the great unsolved mysteries. Turned up for pre-season. Did not Bobby say how he's at the club after what happened?
Yeah. It was on World of Sport one Sunday, and Geelong hadn't started the year very well, and I think Bobby was saying, well, there's a few players did it, and they go, come on, Bobby, name names. The old name names, Ross, you know, and he goes, name names. He goes, all right, and he got the footy record, and he started going down the list like he did with the Brisbane Bears famously once. He went the Geelong list, and I think number six was first Wayne Russell. No. Number 10, Darren Troy, too slow. Anyway, he got the 16, Billy Bounce. And how he's still at the club after what happened over the summer. And they go, your votes, please, Bob. I'm saying, no, find out what happened. It's 40 years ago or something, 30 years ago. And so what did happen down at the club over the summer? it's one of the great mysteries.
And will remain so, it would appear.
Yeah, and of course, Ross and Russ had a segment this week on their program about myths, M-Y-T-H-S.
Yes.
And so there's another topic in great mysteries, isn't there?
Yes. Every time I hear myths, I think of the Muppet Show movie. Do you remember the original Muppet Show movie?
No.
And right through the whole thing, there's a running gag where they say, no, myth. Myth. And every time they say myth, this girl steps out from behind a board and goes, yes. And it just goes right through the entire program.
Can't do that anymore.
No, absolutely not.
No.
I may or may not have not been listening to Pulse's Breakfast on that morning when the myths were discussed. And there was one that I was going to ring through, but I couldn't get through. And the bloke I texted, he sometimes forgets to look at his phone. I think I'm right in saying Dave D of Dave D, Bluey, Georgie, Dave-O, that band, whatever it was called.
Dave D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick and Titch.
Yes, I always get the names out of order. I think I'm right in saying Dave D became a police officer and was the first on the scene when Mark Bolan was killed in a car accident and ended up with Mark Bolan's guitar.
Phew. That would have been a new clubhouse leader there, Ross.
Well, that would have been. And if I'm the person you texted, I did not ever receive it, I assure you. Neil, that's up there with Bob Brown working in the hospital in London when they brought Jimi Hendrix's body.
Mm. Mm-hmm. And Ross Cameron has just texted through to say he was the Ross I texted.
Got the wrong Ross.
No, he wasn't. No, I did text the wrong person, actually.
And as your caller said the other morning, not only that, they said Bob Brown went out and did the press conference.
Mm.
There must be. Is there black and white footage of that somewhere?
But you know, just while you're at it, you know the extraordinary thing about Ross Cameron being the person you texted, if it's the same Ross Cameron?
He's no longer on TV. Or is it a different Ross Cameron again?
Ah, there's a Ross Cameron who lives next door to me who's a mad music friend. Ian and Neil and Rob, whilst we've got you, one of the great mysteries for me that I've never, ever solved is that there's a song I'm very fond of from the 1960s called Don't Let Your Love, I can't remember the song now, but it's by Hamilton, Joe, Frank and Reynolds.
Don't pull your love out on me, baby. Maybe.
Yeah, right. Is that three people or four?
Yeah, good question. Hamilton, Joe.
No, I think it's Hamilton, Joe, Frank.
Oh, that's
and
all one.
So, no, I think Hamilton, Joe, Frank and Reynolds.
Oh, Joe Frank is a one.
Three.
Yeah, Hamilton, comma, Joe Frank.
I believe so. Just talk amongst yourselves while I go to my extensive music library here.
And we might just be able to pull it out. He's done this before many times.
And is that like, what's the other one, that other one that had a name like that too?
John Ford Coley, England Dan and John Ford Coley.
Well, I was thinking of someone and Sister Rose, didn't
And there was the original Cornelia. Yeah, I'll come to that one.
Is that the original? It's Too Late to Turn Back Now.
Yes.
With someone, was it Cornelia's brothers and Sister Rose?
Yes, I think it was. Yes.
There's another segment for out of 7:30 this week.
that could be three people or 12.
Here we go.
Yeah. This is 94.7 of the Pulse. Oh, it's Neil Butler spinning the tunes.
Going for a top of 15. Oh, I've crashed the lyric.
Now,
it is a good tune.
I can confirm, looking at my music library, it is Hamilton, comma, Joe Frank, ampersand Reynolds. So it is three people.
Okay. There you go. There's a mystery solved, Ross.
Well, and that's good news for them. They only have to whack up the cash.
And England Dan and John Ford Coley. England Dan was actually Dan, I think it was Seals, as in Seals and Croft. His brother.
Is it Seals and Croft or Seals and Crofts?
No, Croft.
He's a singular.
Yes, okay. Yes. When you get England Dan with him, though, they are the Crofts.
Well, I thought, Ross, it might have been a bit like those players that played for Geelong back in the 60s.
Who swapped S's.
Yeah. Ken Newland became Ken Newlands because Gareth Andrews gave him his S and became Gareth Andrew. Jack Dyer was always got him back to front. It was fantastic.
I've got a question for you, Neil. When I texted Covey about a month ago.
You'll be still waiting for a response. That's generally our experience.
No, he's absolutely red hot. I texted him. I said, I've just had a beer with a very lovely man in his 70s, who represented Victoria seven times, if I say that, Covey, seven times, and whose name was often taken for Geelong's Sam.
John Newnham, who is a friend of the show here and a very close friend of Rob Cameron's.
Mm. Yes, I actually shear his sheep, Ross, and a delightful chap he is.
Does he give you free bus tickets?
He does. He does. And he's got a set of bus stairs leading from his house up in the yard, and they're very, very difficult to get up for a broken-down old shearer.
He had Newnham's bus lines.
Yeah.
Well, it turns out from the four people involved in this discussion on the wireless, I'm the last person to admit it.
And he was on the TV about a week ago.
Yeah.
2 weeks ago. He was at the Fitzroy football ground. They'd finally got around to naming a stand after the great man.
Kevin Murray.
Yeah.
Yeah. Johnny Newnham. What number was he?
20.
Thank you. You butt out. You know that. Butt out, butler. Talking of buses. Get that bus out, butler.
That's never, ever been used to me, ever. You can imagine. That's original work right there.
Ross, for you living in a little metropolis like Birragurra, it's the little gems like Johnny Newnham and others that give you that touch of the old life with the new life. It must be quite fantastic because he is just a fine human being, that one.
And throw in, throw in the Brownlow medal, eh?
Yeah. Yeah. The great Gary Dempsey.
Gary Dempsey.
Is he down at Berry?
Yeah.
Is he?
Yeah, Dempo.
Right.
And you got the McLaughlin clan just down the road?
Yeah, well, yes.
Just on the fringe of the village?
Gillan and his mother Sylvia are in the village. And a myth, Covey, if you could solve for me, one I could have put up yesterday.
Mm.
Did Kevin Murray really say he would give his Brownlow back if he could get rid of his tattoos?
Ooh, that's a good question. It rings a bell.
That was true.
Hmm. Because, of course, you know, when he met the Queen, and also when he was presented with the Brownlow by Sir Rowan Delacombe, what was he wearing?
Long sleeves.
Long sleeves to hide the tattoos.
Is that right?
I think his mother told him to.
Yeah. and both of them.
So
as distinct from his sleeve.
So when Dusty Martin picks up his fourth Norm Smith medal, he'd have to go up in a tracksuit.
Probably not a myth for this show, Ross, but next time you're talking to John, if you haven't already discovered how Kevin Bulldog Murray got his nickname, that's a story worth listening to.
I'll ask him on Monday, unless Kobe knows.
Yeah.
There's a group of chaps in Melbourne who have a thing called the Kaji Club, and they all put their votes in at the start of the year of who they think will get the most votes in the Brownlow at every club, and they have a big dinner at lunch at the end of the year, and they give a replica medal to the fella that wins it, and that. And they always have a former Brownlow medalist there, and they had Kevin Murray a couple of years back, and I was MC, and they were telling me Kevin was coming down from
Arcadia,
up near Shep,
Ardmona, Arcadia, one of those up there.
So they put him up at the Hilton. And one of the chaps said to him, you know, Kevin, we can come over and pick you up and bring you over to the MCG, because they do lunch at G. And Kevin said, oh, I think I know where it is. I'll be right.
Because Kev doesn't mind a chat either.
He's a beauty.
And we, as you may have picked up along the way, Ross, Ian, I barrack for the Brisbane Lions and have been a member now for 40 years. And Kevin was my absolute childhood hero. Like, there was no one else, except Johnny Newnham, in case he's listening, of course. And Kev goes to the family days still. This year he's not too well. He didn't get to the opening of his grandstand. But he gets to the family days, and they have all of the Brisbane Lions list are there, like all 46 players, all the officials are there. And there's one queue that goes for miles. Kevin. And that's the one to go and see Kevin Murray. And everyone is invited to wear the Brownlow. That, to me, is like the Pope offering to let you wear his mitre. No way in the world am I putting that on, because that's just almost a religious icon. But he sits you down and he says, so, Neil, tell us, Neil, tell us, how long have you been following Fitzroy and the Lions? Oh, you know, 1966 or whatever. And he goes, oh, yeah, what's your favourite? Meanwhile, the queue is halfway back to the city because everyone gets to chat.
Well, this happened to us. We did a Could Have Been show in Shepparton, and Kevin was in the crowd with a couple of mates, and I do this thing where I go out in the audience with the mic and stick it in front of a few people. And I said, Kevin Murray's on the end of the aisle. So I go and put him in front of Kevin. We had to abandon the show for 45 minutes while Kevin answered my first question.
Yeah, how are you?
And then after the show, we're out in the foyer, you know, and people want to get autographs. No one came to us. They all went to Kevin Murray. And have you seen his shoes?
Oh, no, he's normally sitting down.
Oh, he wears these shoes. You'd love these. They're maroon, and on the top part of your shoe, what's that? I don't know what that's called. That's blue, and it's got a gold lion sewn into the top of the shoe.
Really? I have seen them.
And he wears them everywhere. The Fitzroy shoes. They are just fantastic.
Now, can I ask a question? Related to that, another myth, possibly. I was once, and your job is to guess the player. I'm going to say he plays for Fitzroy in the 1980s. I was once told he was so conscious of his clothing that he had to be impeccably dressed that he didn't wear a seatbelt in his car because it might crease. He once won a game for Fitzroy in famous circumstances at Waverley Park.
I'm just going to say a few allegedly, just in case there's anyone listening about the seatbelt. That's okay. Yep.
Mickey Conlon?
Correct, Ian.
Oh, he was always beautiful, he turned out, even without clothes on, too. He was wasn't he a specimen?
Mickey Conlon walks on water, fa-la-la-la-la, la-la-la-la. Mickey Conlon, he's our man. If he can't do it, no one can.
One of the great two-possession games, that one, too, against Essendon.
Yes.
Was it a Robert Clomp, was it?
Oh, yeah, I think he out-clomped Clomp.
He did.
I was sitting next to an Essendon supporter that day, just in front of the old scoreboard at the, what would it be, eastern end of Waverley, and there was a chap sitting next to me who gave it to me all day, and as for Conlon, he's a complete waste of space. After the game, I turned around to look at him, and he was crying. And it was one of the great moments of 1986.
Question. Who did he receive the handball from?
I can answer that question too. It doesn't come from very far away from where you sometimes hang out, Ross.
He's down your way, Ross.
Is he?
Mm.
In fact, he was the subject of one of John Anderson's questions the other day.
Mm.
from near me, like Winchelsea or Colac.
Getting warmer. Well, not really.
But, yeah. Metaphorically getting warmer.
Getting warm. He put a handball over the top to Mickey.
No. But before someone tells me the answer, I'll throw in another one to make it a double banger.
Yeah.
Tell you what, there's a fair bit of DeWaterley going to be used out today.
Which Essendon player was supposed to be on Mickey Conlon, but wasn't at the time that he kicked that goal?
I think he might have ended up coaching a team down in this town.
I don't know. He was certainly in a landscaping business with Tim Watson.
Oh, I thought it might have. Oh, was it? I thought it was Bomber Thompson.
No, Michael Thompson.
Ah, righto.
Well, I got half a bottle.
Michael Thompson, who was once married to a TV newsreader.
Yes. Bridget Duclos. How many people can we bring into this conversation today?
So now, you still haven't got who give the handball over the top.
He has worn the jumper that he, the number that he wore, he has worn more times than anybody else in AFL history, VFL history.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yes. And it's not Paul Ruse who's done that wearing the number one, another Fitzroy player.
A much higher number.
Mm, significantly
Gary
so.
Gary Wilson.
No.
Even bigger number.
No. And...
And Gary Wilson was always going to be up against it because he wore 29 and so did Kevin Bartlett.
Did he not have the nickname...
Associated with a television show.
Associated with a television show.
Yep.
One half of a television show.
Morecambe. One Ronnie.
Yeah. His nickname is Mork, as in Mork and Mindy.
Oh, he's from Mortlake.
He is indeed from Mortlake.
First name?
Oh, God.
First name, Leon.
Surname, Harris.
Leon Harris from Mork Lake.
Yes. Mork Lake. I'll just keep talking amongst yourselves because I'm just looking.
No, I wouldn't have got that in a long time.
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, while Cove's looking that up, I know we have to do this. We might just pause momentarily if we can, and we might just do a sponsorship break.
Is there an ad you might like to play here to make Cove feel at home? I'm not quite sure if it's on the list, but it'd be very timely.
Oh, well, let me just bring the mics down and play four or five sponsorship announcements. Ross, you've never had to do that before. And we will talk soon. This is the Two Blokes Chatting Radio Show, 29 minutes past 10 o'clock on a Saturday morning.
The Committee for Geelong provides strategic leadership to leverage the economic and social prosperity of the region. By encouraging innovation and debate, we focus on ways to overcome challenges and provide a united voice on the issues facing Geelong. As the region confronts the impacts of COVID-19, we're confident we have the strength, humanity and resilience needed to rebound and design our best future. Find out more at committeeforgeelong.com.au.
Station sponsor.
Tax time means money back to you. Davidson's Accountants can help you get expert advice on what you're entitled to claim. Davidson's Accountants are Geelong's leading accounting firm, known for their professionalism, expertise and knowledge. 9 out of 10 clients would recommend them to others. Phone 5221 6399 or visit davidsons.com.au to book your face-to-face or online appointment today. Mention The Pulse to get a 10% discount on the cost of your tax return. Station sponsor.
The City of Greater Geelong is taking care of our community.
Mulai sekarang dan selanjutnya, the City of Greater Geelong memberikan pelayanan kepada masyarakat setempat. Pelayanan dan perlindungan masyarakat, komunitas, dan bisnis di masa-masa sulit seperti ini dapat dilihat di situs berikut ini. www.geelongaustralia.com.au/covid-19 atau hubungi pelayanan dengan berbagai bahasa melalui Translating and Interpreting Service di nomor telepon 131450 dengan menyebutkan kantor The City of Greater Geelong.
Sponsoring The Pulse. Port of Geelong is a busy international waterway that means jobs for around 5,000 people and millions of dollars for the local economy. The Port of Geelong. It's big and it's beautiful, but make sure you keep clear of the big ships. A message from the Victorian Regional Channels Authority. Station sponsor.
I am a line marker.
Have you lost your way? What you need is Geelong Line Marking. Owner-operator Wayne Skippy Carroll has over 30 years' experience in line marking, on-ground signage and stenciling. Geelong Line Marking specialise in car parks, factory safety lines, and Skippy can get over your sports ovals and courts in a flash, just like he did in his playing days. Check out Geelong Line Marking on their website or Facebook page. Mention the Pulse for a special deal. Geelong Line Marking, sponsors of 94.7 The Pulse.
Indeed, they are. It is 28 minutes to 11 o'clock. This is the Two Blokes Chatting Radio Show. My name's Neil. His name's Rob. His name's Ian. And the bloke on the phone's name's Ross. Where were we?
Can I just say that that last public service announcement about Skippy and his line marking featuring Greg Champion, this is your 100th show. We congratulate you on that. That's been played at least twice a show for the last 100. And Greg gave me an invoice to bring in for the royalties. Okay, so I was hoping that would come on. And just on a serious note, gentlemen, I've maligned Mick Conlon, and I apologise.
And look, he's standing in the foyer. He wants to have a chat to you.
Look, Ross.
Yes.
I was acting on information I believed to be true at the time, and for that. I regret, I'm not apologising, I regret that I said he had the two possessions. If I've caused any offence, yeah. Well, I regret that. Never so sorry. Mick Conlon in that particular match had 5 kicks, took 3 marks and had 1 handball and kicked, so he had 6 disposals, kicked 1 goal, 1. So it's the best 6 disposal game you've ever seen.
And I think Klomp got 8.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he did.
Yeah. Robert Klomp turned up to be a junior coach at a football club that I was associated with. And everyone, he'd say, I'm Robert Klomp. And everyone would say, how's your TV? That football club was the Beverly Hills Junior Football Club and renowned for a long time as being the place that Paul Roos played. And more recently, everyone's running, of course, Christian Petrarca played there as well.
Yeah.
So we're claiming him as well. Mark Murphy, a few went through.
I'm amused there's a suburb called Beverly Hills. Why didn't they go on with it and have Las Vegas? And you know?
Well, you'll be even more amused to know that the primary school that I went to from grade 1 to grade 6 was called Beverly Hills Primary School.
Well, there you go.
The section, now for those who know the eastern suburbs of Melbourne, the section between what is now the Eastern Freeway and Whitehorse Road along Blackburn Road was going to be known as Beverly Hills, and someone got it wrong, a bit like having a police station in St Arnold that should have been in St Albans, and they ended up not using the name. It became known as Blackburn North, and they thought, well, we've got this name, we better put the primary school in, and they did.
Well, if Two Blokes Chatting had 2 bottles of debauchery, rewrite the rules, clean that one. The question, what high school does one pass when travelling between Coolangatta Airport and the Gold Coast?
Is that Miami?
Yes.
Oh, Ian, you would.
Well, I'll tell you something. Years ago when I actually left newspapers, I went into radio full time with John Blackman on 3UZ, and John now is at... You must know, you got no time to actually concentrate on the program with all the texts that come in, Ross. Because Blackers has now become prolific, I imagine.
He is. The prolific ones would, present company.
Is that a complaint?
No, I've trained off a bit.
Yeah.
Blackers. Rodney Hogg popped up the other day.
Oh, really? From the West?
From the West, he did. Yeah. He must have been up very early.
Yeah. Ted?
Oh, yes, Ted Bailey.
No, and what about the other Ted? Advertising Ted?
Oh, yeah, Ted Horton.
Yeah.
The guru. It's a pleasure to receive them. I'm not complaining.
Now, well, just to pick up on the theme of Miami High School, just adjacent to Miami High School, there is an ice factory called Miami Ice, which was a play on the name of the TV show. Which film clip was filmed, which song was filmed standing outside of Miami Vice?
I thought the question was going to be, which consonant was inserted by a graffiti artist?
I don't know, but for some reason, I know David Bowie filmed a film clip in Australia.
Yeah, that was in regional New South Wales in a pub.
Right.
Is this an Australian artist?
An Australian artist, and in fact, a bit of a hint, someone in the video clip has been on this show more than once.
I was going to go with, Choir Boys, Run to Paradise or something.
Well, funnily enough, we had Mark Gable on 3 weeks ago from Choir Boys, but it wasn't then.
No.
Right, country of origin?
Queensland.
No, country. No, Queensland is a different country where we've got a football team up there. No. In fact, a chap called John Farnham.
Did he?
Yeah, along with Lisa Edwards, who's a friend of the show, filmed 2 Strong Hearts standing outside of Miami Ice.
Okay. Yeah, there's another topic in there about locations. Was it Dexy in the Midnight Runners or something that did one sort of greyhound track in England? That was Tony Leonard's favourite film clip. That's how he knew it. Now, just back to Blackers. When I started...
Didn't ACDC have a song called that, Back in Blackers?
Full-time in radio at the old 9273 UZ.
The and greater.
They came in one time. The late Clyde Simpson, who was a bit of a legend big legend in 3XY days and then at Eon FM, and he was running UZ at the time. Everything was... He'd come in after the show at 8:30 saying, "Oh, rock and roll, baby! Oh, this morning, rock and roll!" Clicking his fingers, and you know, so we're just doing a talk show here, Clyde. "Oh, no, hey, rock and roll." So he came in one morning and said, "Hey, I got an OB organised. You blokes, fantastic." "Oh, yeah," Blackman's going, "Oh, yeah, where are we going?" He said, "Ah, we're going to be broadcasting from Miami." "Oh, wow, magnificent." It was a vacant block of land at Miami on the Gold Coast, flogging real estate for some local developer.
The local version of Alan Bond.
Yeah. Ian, I just thought we could do a top seven. We'll get you on as a guest.
Yeah.
Top seven before seven John Blackman moments.
Oh, yeah.
Saturday. Because he's just wonderful, Blackers, and it's unfair to spring it on you, because the one that comes to mind for me is... They play the film clip of what was the big comeback song? You're the Voice.
Mm.
And do you remember it starred, was Darren Hinch in it with Jackie Weaver?
Correct. Yep.
And she throws something like a dish at him.
That's right, in the kitchen.
And he ducks.
Yeah.
And it hits the wall behind him.
Yes.
And they're playing the film clip and Blackers over the top goes, "Damn, missed."
Yeah, like that was after they'd had a falling out, Ross.
They had a falling out, yes.
And he'd left AW and then went to the ill-fated. You always use the words ill-fated in front of the ill-fated AK when they yes. when they did that two-state thing with New South Wales. It was never going to work.
Yeah. Question with that notice to you, special guests today, Ross. I don't know how many evenings you do with the. Sporting guest speaker, probably more luncheons, but Cove, you've done thousands. Has there been a particularly memorable, inappropriate moment that one of these people may have delivered along the lines of the Blackers comment? You'd have seen a few.
Remembering we are on live radio.
Oh, no. Everything's been entirely appropriate, everything we've done. I do recall, there's one for you, Neil, being a Fitzroy man. Years ago, the Fitzroy players, who we got quite close to because they were like a country footy club in the city, and we used to knock around a lot of those Fitzroy fellas. And they 1 or 2 years they used the Bulleen Country Club as their sort of.
At that stage, it had been changed to the Manningham Centre to make it sound impressive. Yes.
And so we went out to do a pleasant Sunday afternoon for the Players' Trip Fund, and Simon Thorpe, who I see sadly passed away recently, Ross.
Oh, really?
Who was Vince Marasco?
Yeah.
And of course, Mitchell Fairclough, Slim Whittle also passed away in recent weeks. That's what my colleagues told me, that Simon had passed away as well. Anyway, his great party trick was, Ross?
I'm thinking Con's great... Oh, no,
it was Vince.
He knew every railway station on every suburban train line in Australia and...
Really? Yeah, he came out. So here we are at the Bulleen thing, and then someone says, he comes out and goes, you know, name the thing. Someone says, Glenn Waverley, righto, Flinders Street, Richmond. He does the whole line in order. And he could do them backwards too.
Yeah.
Well, that's just catching the train back to town, isn't it?
So
and postcodes.
Postcodes, yeah. So anyway, he came on that. He's brained them with that. And then he decided he would actually then show them how to make coleslaw. And he immediately started gnawing on a carrot, followed by a cabbage, and then spat it out at the audience. He said, "Here's your coleslaw."
Did you, and Covey, what about Con Marasco? Did you ever see Con Marasco live on stage? His trick?
Oh, the cigarette in the mouth?
He would put a lit cigarette on the toe of his shoe and kick it up into his mouth.
Yeah. I did a few gigs with him when it didn't work the first time.
When he worked the first 1,500, he would just keep on doing it.
He wouldn't give up.
Accounts for why he's blind in his left eye, though.
We were, Darren and I were filling in for you there one time. So when we were doing the show full time, and We had nothing for the rumour file. Darren said, I've got one. And he said, who's the well-known, you know, local comedian who was out at, you know, High Point West on doing the, you know, the centre court, you know, entertaining the... And anyway, apparently the story we said, this is pathetic from Darren. Connie's out there doing this thing at centre court at High Point, and someone on the first level threw a rolled-up bit of consumed chewy and hit him on the back of his head. And said, yeah, that's... Darren said, oh, who was the comedian who was assaulted by a piece of chewing gum? Have you mentioned that, Darren? We got the giggles on air about this, and, you know, had to go to a very long break. Yeah, so that's the only thing I know about Connie. Cigarettes and a hit by a piece of chewy at High Point West.
Well, it's 18 minutes to 11, folks. We're wondering who those voices are. We've got Ross Stevenson on the phone. We've got Ian Cover in the studio, along with Neil and Rod.
I had a question for you, Ross.
Yes,
sir. We've run out of the Pinot, so we're going for the Tempranillo now. I was just talking off air that I do a column every second week in the Geelong Advertiser, where I do a bit of a walk down memory lane and talk about games I went to and players. Anyway, last week I did Henry Playfair, one of the great names, Henry Playfair. He came from Holbrook in New South Wales, Ross.
I'm ahead of you, Ian.
What's his nickname?
Oh, Submarine.
Very close. Oh, yeah, the name of the submarine?
Oh.
You spend a lot of weekends in it.
I don't know whether I've ever known the name of the submarine, like Polaris or something.
Well, there is a national park close to where you spend weekends.
Leon Harris.
No, bears the name.
No, national park. I know we've got the Otways.
Well, there you go. It's the HMAS Otway.
Is it? I've never.
Yeah, yeah. And in fact, I was going up to New South Wales last April, and I detoured into Holbrook to do the obligatory selfie in front of the Otway. And Henry Playfair told me, this is amazing. He was at a football club where they had creativity with their nicknames because the coach said, hey, what are you doing over there, Otway? Called him Otway.
I always think one of the most interesting nicknames, just in terms of the country that we are, is Gary. For Nathan Lyon. What does that mean to anyone from New South Wales or Queensland?
Yeah, they'd be thinking, maybe that's his middle name.
In fact, what we would do if we're on the wireless is we would try to.
We are on the wireless, Ross.
Who is the most famous Gary from New South Wales or Queensland? The most famous Gary in rugby league.
Where did Gary Owen come from? Was he a New South Welshman? Yeah. He or she or wherever?
It's all one word, isn't it, the Gary Owen?
Yeah, I think it's Mr. or Mrs. Gary Owen.
Okay.
Yeah. Whenever I think of Gary, I think of Gary Wilson, but again, that's not going to help the... And Gary Lineker, he played something, didn't he? Soccer or something in the UK?
Yeah, he's big.
Oh, yeah.
Was Lazarus Gary?
Yeah, he was. Wore number 31.
In fact, in English Premier Division, there was a very, very famous Gary Ablett.
There was.
There was, indeed.
Yes. Was there not a Kevin Sheedy playing about the same time?
Yes, indeed. Mm.
That's the extent of my knowledge of the English Premier League. Despite David Armstrong's insistence to regularly play clips from the commentary rather than telling us who won the football the day before.
Yeah. No, that's only if Armo has got nothing to report from the NBA.
The other day, I was quite pleased that they didn't put the result on because a team that you like beat the team that I like, and he actually had footage from a broadcast of a game of soccer in England, then Ariana Titmus winning the world record, and then, yesterday Hawthorn beat Brisbane. That was it.
I always think about English Premier League, Division 1, I think we used to call it then, when it was growing up. But there was a joke there to be done for decades. It had never been done until Spike Milligan did it, when he did the results of English Premier Division instead. And in English Division 1 overnight, Arsenal won, Manchester United didn't.
He's still one of my favourite pieces of ridiculous TV comedy, Spike Milligan, and I still use it to this day, and people don't know what I'm doing. I'm doing it to amuse myself. He was sitting doing Newsreader, and someone hands a piece of paper in, you know, like breaking news, and he goes, I've just been handed a piece of paper, and goes back to what he's reading. So, to this day, when I've been doing a gig, someone will hand me a piece, I've just been handed a piece of paper. Right, the next award is, you know.
There was a lady who came into the Sullivans towards the end when poor old Grace met her demise in England. Mm. Dave remarried. And I can't remember her name. She was an Australian actress, I think. And she once had been on stage for a tour with Spike Milligan, a two-person show. Mm-hmm. And she said she would walk out on stage to start the show, and sometimes she would not get a word in for an hour and a half. Other times she had to talk for an hour and a half. Mm. He was just so unpredictable.
Mm. I saw him at the Comedy Theatre, and he sat on stage just, you know, monologuing, and he had a red tin bucket beside him with fire written on it. And he said, because he came out and said, just in case there's trouble, I'm organised, I'm the fire warden tonight. And he holds up this bucket, and he talks for about 20 minutes, and he goes, now I'm going to take a break. And he pulled a bottle of white wine out of the fire bucket and consumed it. While he had a chap playing the piano, Ross, for another twin pack. The fellow playing the piano just filled in a bit of time while he had a swig of the Tempranillo. And the chap playing the piano, he wrote...
Queensland?
Sorry?
Is he from Queensland?
No, he's from England, and he wrote the music for a TV theme.
Leon Harris.
No, and he was known by one word name.
Vangelis.
Close. No.
He was Greek, wasn't he?
No. Kenny.
Kenny?
I think Kenny might have written the music for the Minder theme.
All right.
I was thinking of Minder.
Yeah.
Which seems rather extraordinary. One moment I remember from Spike Milligan's life was a story told by Nettie Seagoon, Harry Seacombe, who said he was walking down the street in London one day, they'd just been out for dinner or something like that, he's walking down with Spike Milligan, and they walked past a funeral director's shop, you know, a funeral home, and Spike Milligan stopped, went into the funeral director business, lay on the front bench and yelled, shop.
Oh, that's fantastic.
One of those, another resident of New South Wales, of course, Spike Milligan.
From the delightfully named?
Woi Woi.
Woi. Yeah.
Now, your mate, Greg Champion, wrote a song called Never Call Wagga Wagga Wagga.
Yeah.
Well, Woi Woi gets a run in that, I think.
If Spike Milligan had barracked for Fitzroy, he would have been a Roy boy from Woi Woi. There's a bit of Mike McCull Jones about that one.
For the two bottles of the bottle, his mother was from Woi Woi.
Yes.
Spike was born in India.
That's right.
Yes, no, but he ended up living there towards the end, I think. Did a touch of the Leo Sayers.
Well, when he came to visit Mum, he had lengthy stays there and then went back, I think. Yeah.
Bit like
absolute genius.
Bit like the movie to the Breakfast Programme and don't move out.
Yeah, no, he's a genius. At the risk of being totally... Look, I'm quoting in the interest of accuracy on that Spike Milligan show. That's another one where he's reading something out. He does... you know, I, Spike Milligner. He goes, ugh, I'll kill that typist.
He also occasionally referred to himself as Spike Milligner, the well-known typographical error.
A well-known typographical error, yeah. Which I think emanated from the typist he's going to kill. And he did King Canute. And he was King Canute sitting on top of a chair at Brighton Beach or something, and he's going, go back, go back, go back. And then there's a whole lot of people in suits coming up out of the water going, we have passports, we have passports. Wouldn't be able to do it today. I'm just quoting something I saw on television once.
Historical evidence. Historical.
Times have changed.
Yes.
Times have changed.
But, I mean, they would have been down at the beach, built this chair, put him in all the robes, for a sketch that went 10 seconds, if that, you know.
Yeah, it's extraordinary, isn't it?
He did he must have done 3 years of a show that started, I think it was called Q6.
Yeah.
Q7, and then Q8, and K-U-W-A-I-T.
Yeah.
talk about things you wouldn't do now, that's not tremendously problematical.
This is Ross Stevenson speaking.
Yes, and we don't have a delay button.
No, that would be considered to be... Have you ever seen Pakistani Daleks?
No.
No.
Oh. Just...
That says it all, really.
Oh.
It's just incredible that someone had a mind that would work that way.
Yeah.
What a genius.
Mm. Absolutely.
There's another top seven that's seven, and lists of TV shows you've never watched. You know, because you can quote all these things from, you know, Spike Milligna and all those fantastic things. I can't give you one line from an episode of Seinfeld.
No.
No, I wouldn't give you two bob for it.
Yeah. I used to fly quite a lot, very tight arms, but towards the end of the day. But going up to Sydney and Melbourne, and they used to play the same episode of Seinfeld. And you could tell, as you're flying over Seymour, everyone would go... because that was the same episode every time.
They found the one gag.
Yeah, they did. Yes, that was. That's why they kept playing it over and over. I suspect.
There's a few more like that. Because when you mentioned the Muppets before, I don't think I even saw it, an episode of the TV show, let alone the movie version.
You should go and see the episode where Kermit interviews Paul Simon, and throughout the show they have the same running joke: 50 ways to leave your lover. 50 ways to love your liver. 50 ways to leave your...
which Greg Champion, of course, famously did as 50 ways to lose your tagger.
I would throw in four favourite questions ever asked on any television show in the world.
Would this be one from Norman Gunston?
It was.
Yes. Yeah. Who to? Was it to Linda McCartney?
I think it was to Paul McCartney, but you will correct me, Ian.
Oh, no. Same areas.
I'm assuming that at the time, Sale of the Century was on 9 at the same time that Willacy was on 7. Does that sound about right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, 7 o'clock.
And Willacy at 7 said Norman Gunston along to Paul McCartney's press conference. He eventually was called upon to pose his question. And he said, Mr. McCartney, Mr. Willacy would like to apologise for not being here in person, but the carryover champion's only 5 to the BMW.
That was the same press conference that he said to Linda McCartney, you don't look Japanese.
And did he say, what are you doing on stage in front of a roll-top desk?
the story, here's a myth for you, was that the sound guy would not turn up the volume on Linda's piano.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah. I actually saw Paul McCartney, and we've got 5 minutes, folks. We're going to cut this off very shortly, despite the fact it's a 20-minute conversation. I saw Paul McCartney at Amy Park about 3 years ago, and the way he does that now, his drummer has the same tone of voice, so when it gets too high, the drummer takes over and Paul drops into second. Yeah, extraordinary. The other thing that was really funny that day, I don't know whether you've been to Amy Park, the Melbourne Rectangular Stadium, as it was known during the ABC days, but the people coming out waiting for the lift with Zimmer frames. It was really funny. There was a queue up. It's extraordinary.
I have a question for Ian.
Yes.
Who was the most famous person to have reported from Amy Park?
Amy Parks.
Correct.
In fact, I did some gigs up country with Amy Parks before she got onto television. I got very excited. I said, wonder if she'll ever end up on telly. And when she did, she was outside Amy Park. It was fantastic.
Yeah.
Yes, we're still looking for someone called MCG or Dockland Stadium.
They'll find one. You mentioned, was it Amy Park where you saw McCartney? Here's one for you, Ross. There was great fanfare about a live performance at Princes Park of the opera Aida, where they had a live elephant walking around the back of the set and everything. Who played one of the spear carriers? We were at Princes Park.
Princess Park, surely. Mm.
I have no idea, but just so I can employ one moment of Rex Hunt on this radio, a cooter fire to me.
No, closer. Justin Madden.
The Honourable.
Yeah, he was up the back so you could see him, you know. He towered over the rest of the spear carriers.
Mm. Now, just on Princess Park and the Princess Theatre and so forth, did you know that, in fact, the Princess Theatre is the Princess's Theatre? If you go past, there is an apostrophe after the S in Princess on the front wall.
That'll be Spike Milligan's typist again. Put an apostrophe in. Oh, dear.
Gentlemen, I have to leave you to go somewhere else. Ross, thank you so much.
Don't you go through till 11?
Yeah, next door.
I've got to go next door.
Ross Stevenson, thank you so much. You have brightened everyone's day, as you do all the time. Looking forward to catching up with you and the great Johnny Newnham in Birragara one day, I hope.
No worries, and it's been fun. Thank you all.
Well, it's been a nice thing to do to celebrate the 100th version of the edition of the Two Blokes Chatting, which became Four Blokes Chatting today. And I think we probably won't do it for another 100 either, Ross.
You can catch Ross from 5:30 Monday morning on 693 3AW and 3AW.com.au. Thanks for joining us, Ross.
No worries. See you.
See you, Ross.
Thanks, mate. There he is. And Ian Cover, thank you for drumming into the studio.
Before I go, actually, that was a prop for that little gag before about the invoice. There's actually a card for you and Ross.
Oh, that's very kind.
If we're on television, people would see that, so you better describe it and perhaps read it for the benefit of the listeners.
For a special couple, I'm so emotionally overtaken. For a special couple on your anniversary, to a special couple, to Neil and Rob, the Two Blokes Chatting, wishing you both a lovely day of happy celebrations on the occasion of your 100th show. Here's to the next 100. Best wishes, Cove.
There you go.
Now, I'll give Ross, what's his name? Rob, I've lost track already. hang on, I've got to do that. Are you there? Over.
Do I work?
Mm. Yes, we can hear you. Thank you. That's very kind. Thanks, Cove.
I just brought a card in for
you. I do appreciate that. And, Cove, I'm very disappointed we didn't have a lot of time to spend on the trifecta. The Geelong Cricket Club now has at the head of the Australian cricket team
Andre
Borovec joining Aaron Finch and our own Ronnie McDonald. Mm. That is just amazing, and we probably should talk about that at length some other time, but that is a great, great story for local cricket.
No, it's a great story, and Borra's really good at it, and so's Andrew McDonald. They'll be terrific, and of course Finchie.
I better do the formal stuff to finish the program. Right. Someone needs do that, don't they? Thank you, Ian Cover, for joining us. The Could Have Been Champions now on 3MP and around Victoria, 4 o'clock on a Friday at noon, and doing all the things they have been doing for 40 years. Thank you so very much for joining us.